Hello, my name is Riku Jäntti and this is Introduction to Signals and Systems. The objective for this lecture is to go through the basic concepts and the main terminology of signals and systems. So we will discuss what is signal, what is a system, what is spectrum, and what does it mean to filter or modulate the signal. Okay, so let's start from the basics. What is signal? A signal is typically a function of time, t. So we have the time axis here, and then the signal has amplitude, for instance, a voltage or current. We can have signals that are continuous in time and continuous in amplitude, meaning that this is a continuous curve. Then we can discretize it in time by taking samples, so we have a discrete time signal. And typically when we take samples, we also quantize, so we get discrete time and discrete amplitude signal. So this is what the signal would look like after analog to digital conversion. Then when we have this kind of digital signal and we use it to generate analog signal, we have analog to digital converter, after which the signal would have continuous in time, but discrete in amplitude. We can classify signal based on their characteristics. So we can have deterministic signals. And in the case of deterministic signal, we know the future behavior of the amplitude as a function of time. And we can have stochastic or random signals, in which case the amplitude values are not known in advance, but are taken from some probability distribution. These deterministic signals we can classify to power signals, and the most common power signals are the periodic signals, which have well-defined average, time average power. Then we have energy signals, and there are two classes of energy signals. There are pulses that have finite duration and they have well-defined energy. And we have attenuating signals, which also do have well-defined energy. Then we can have some special signals like step changes or extremely short pulses form the class of their own. Signal amplitude can be real or complex. All natural signals like voltage, current, pressure, or whatever are real. But complex signals is a practical model for modulated signals, which has this sort of form where there is in phase component xit multiplied by cosine omega t plus quadratic component xqt multiplied by sin omega t. So we can, instead of studying the properties of this kind of function, we instead look at this complex signal, which is the in phase minus the quadratic component. And this relation here is through this Euler formula. Here are some examples of time domain signals. So for instance, e.g. G. We have electrodes, we measure voltage there, and this voltage variation is actually measuring the heartbeat of this person. So this is a continuous time signal, and this is a voltage, this is the amplitude. Then we have a blood pressure measurement, where the pressure is actually in the amplitude, but it's still a time signal. Also sound is an example of a pressure signal, so like music or speech. Then example of a complex signal is the base station baseband signal. So here's a narrowband IoT base station communicating with the IoT device. And it is generating baseband signal, which consists of this in-phase and quadratic components, which are then input to the modulator to make this radio frequency signal that is sent out from this antenna. Also different kind of time series form signals, which can be analyze using the same tools that we will discuss here. So for instance, the ice thickness, if I measure it with certain time intervals, I get the discrete time signal that shows how the ice thickness is varying in some part of the sea. So what is a system then? System is an object that defines the relationship between set of signals. We have input signals, which we divide into two classes. We have those which we can manipulate, we call input, those which we cannot manipulate, which we call disturbances, and then there are some output. And we assume that there is a causal relationship between the input and output. Here are some examples of systems. We have electric systems. For instance, in this system, XT is the input voltage, YT is the output voltage. We have mechanical systems where, for instance, location or force are the inputs and outputs. Then we can have biological systems here, like this body of a person. Or we can have chemical systems like this system here, where we have an input concentration going to this tank, and then we measure the output concentration from the flow of water coming out. So let's now look at the signals and systems as kind of a whole. Okay, here's an overall picture of signals and systems. We have some physical system, electrical circuit or mechanical system or flow system or biological process. And we want to measure there something like current, voltage, pressure or something. And whenever we measure something, the measurements are always corrupted by noise. And because of this noise, we usually implement a filter to reduce the amount of noise. Then after that, we could look at the signal in frequency domain. We'll come later to the definition of that. So we could put a spectrum analyzer there. Or we can take samples of that signal, and we have analog-to-digital converter, and then we could have some filters in digital domain, and then we could look at the spectrum in digital domain by using some device like real-time spectrum analyzer. So here is a measured signal. It's corrupted by noise, so it's a noisy signal. Then after sampling, we get these samples, these red dots of that signal, and from those we could actually calculate the spectrum. The spectrum will tell us that okay, there's clearly some DC component, so there's a constant voltage of 0.5 here. So this is the middle peak here, zero frequency, and then this has some nominal frequency around that, so the nominal frequency spikes are here, and then there are also some harmonic frequencies, which we will discuss later on. Okay, so let's discuss the basic concepts of what we need. So signal power and energy, then the power and energy spectrum, and also what does it mean to filter a signal. Okay, so signals, power and energy. Okay, so let's look at very simple circuit. We have voltage source U of T, then we have resistive load R, ohms load, and then we can calculate what is the current flowing through this circuit, which is 1 over R times the voltage. Okay, now let's fix this load to be 1 ohms and look at the instantaneous power. And the power is defined as the voltage times current. And since this load was 1 ohm, so this instantaneous power is proportional now to the voltage squared. And we can calculate then how much energy is consumed by this resistor load during this time interval from T0 to T1 by integrating over this power. And then if you are interested in the time average power consumption, we just divide this energy by the length of the time interval. Okay, so let's now take some generic signal ST, which is not necessarily current or voltage. We nevertheless define its instantaneous power to be its absolute value squared. So now if I integrate from minus t to t, I get how much energy is there in this interval. And if I let this t to go to infinity, so I integrate over the whole time axis, I get the energy of that signal. And we call this signal energy signal if this energy is finite and non-zero. Then we can also look at the power of the signal. So now if we take this interval from minus t per 2 to t per 2 that has length t. So if this is the integral, it gives the energy of that signal in that interval. And then if I divide it by the length of this interval, then this is the average power. And a signal is called a power signal if its average power is non-zero and it's finite. One important class of power signals is periodic signals. So a periodic signal x of t has this property that if I add t0, this is the nominal time of that signal, it repeats. So we have this signal here, and after this interval t0, I get exactly the same signal again. And now we can calculate the average power of this kind of signal. And in notations, it's typically we have this integral, and below this integral, we have this length of the nominal time t0, and then we divide it by this factor t0. And this integral just means that we just take from some arbitrary t0 and integrate from that point to t0 plus t0, this capital t0. So the average power, so if I calculate how much is the average power in this interval, or if I take another interval which has the same length, this capital t0, from here to here, I get exactly the same value. Then if you have these pulses and attenuating signals, so pulse would be at some signal that starts at some particular time, here as time instant minus one, and continues till time one. So it has finite duration, so we call it pulse. So if I square this value and integrate over that, I get what is the energy of this pulse. Also, we have another classes of energy signals or attenuated signals. So for instance, if I have this harmonic oscillator, so and look at its location, then it's slowly going towards zero. So this, if I calculate what is the energy of this signal, it is finite. Quite often we want to look at the signals in frequency domain instead of time domain. So we already in the examples of signals we saw this EEG G signal, and so this is how it looks in time domain. If you then have this is a periodic signal, so it repeats periodically. So now if I take this EEG G signal and look at it in frequency domain, then if it's normal heart, so there is no sickness with this person, you get certain sort of spectrum, which means that how much power there is in certain frequencies. And then if there is some problem with the heart, then this spectrum changes, so we can use it as a diagnostic tool. And now, periodic signals, we typically analyze them using Fourier series. And this picture here tries to relate the time and frequency domain to each other. So this t-axis is the time, and f-axis is the frequency. And this a-axis here is the amplitude. So this signal here, the black, thick black signal, is actually sum of two different sinusoidals with different frequencies, and they have also different amplitudes. So if I look at in frequency domain, I say that okay, there is only one frequency here and it has certain amplitude, and there is another frequency here and that's a certain amplitude. So, and this is the frequency domain view of this signal. And if you have periodic signals, it turns out that they are composed of harmonic frequencies. So here's, if I have a standing wave that is oscillating with frequency 1 over capital T0, that's its nominal frequency. Now twice that frequency is the second harmonic, 3 times is the third harmonic, 4 times is the fourth harmonic, and so forth. And now if you have a real signal, which is periodic, we can always express it in this kind of form, that it contains the DC component, which has zero frequency, and then it has these different frequencies, so there's a frequency component, so one, when k is 1, there's frequency 1 over T0, which is the nominal frequency, then when k is 2, it's the second harmonic, and so forth. So it's a sum of harmonic components, but they have different phases. And these factors x, k, they are obtained through Fourier series. So these are Fourier series coefficients. Okay, so let's now look at this kind of square wave. So this is a signal that is has a nominal frequency T0. So if I just look at the nominal serial frequency component, that's an approximation of the signal with just one sinusoidal. So that has this frequency 1 over T0. Then if I take the third harmonic and sum it, so there's a smaller amplitude third harmonic component, it starts to look a little bit more like this square wave. If I take also the fifth harmonic component, then it starts to look even more, and if I take 7, even more, and so forth, and until if I take infinitely many of those harmonics, I get this signal. Okay, so let's now look at how the power of this signal XT is divided among the different frequency components. So as we saw earlier, this XT, which was assumed to be periodic signal with periodicity T0, so, then it can be expressed as a Fourier series, so that there is a DC component, that's a zero frequency direct current component, so that has the frequency 0, so it's here. Its power is this Fourier series coefficient absolute value squared. Then we have the nominal frequency 1 over T0, and its power is 2 times its first Fourier series coefficient x1 squared, and so forth. And this is a one-sided power spectrum. We'll see also two-sided version soon. So it just shows how the power of the signal is divided among the frequencies. So power spectrum, its unit is watts per hertz. Okay. We can also look at two-sided power spectrum. So in general case, the Fourier series can be written like this. So this is the exponential Fourier series of the same periodic signal as before. And now we write each of these coefficients, the x0, x1, x2, and x3, just like before, except here x0, this is exactly the same as in the previous slide. x1 squared is without this factor 2. If this is real and real signal, then this two-sided power spectrum is symmetric, so x1 and x-1 are the same. For some complex signals, this may not be the case. But for real signals, we have symmetry here. So this power that we have on the nominal frequency 1 over T0, we will also have it on this frequency minus 1 over T0. So which is just means that this phase chart that is rotating here at the frequency 1 over T0 is rotating counterclockwise here and clockwise here. So this negative frequency is just expressed the direction of rotation of this phasor. And it's not as a concept very something very strange. It's just a mathematical concept that is needed. But the two-sided power spectrum has this sort of form. So in most cases it's symmetric, and then the power we obtain when we sum all this squared absolute value of the Fourier series coefficients. And that's actually this formula here. So if you look at the example, we have a square wave signal here as a periodicity, as period T0. If you look at its one-sided power spectrum, we see that, for instance, this term zero is zero because this has no DC component. This average value of the signal is zero. But it has a strong component on the nominal frequency, and then it has a bunch of harmonics. And then if you go from one-sided power spectrum to two-sided power spectrum, it just have this factor two difference, and then it's symmetric around this origin. Okay, so let's look at one practical scenario where we have signal generator here. It generates a square wave signal, which we are looking here with the oscilloscope. And then we have a real-time spectrum analyzer here, and we look at this, how the signal looks in frequency domain. So here we have time domain signal in oscilloscope, and then we have a frequency domain signal here in spectrum analyzer. So in time domain, the square wave signal looks like this. And it's quite common signal. It appears as digital clock signal, or it is also quite often used as a test signal. Also in certain switching power supplies, the AC that they generate actually looks like this. So this is how the spectrum analyzer looks like. So we have the frequency here on x-axis and the power here in the y-axis. And this power is given in terms of dBm. So that's the in decibel scale compared to 1 milliwatt. And then if I compare this result with this, what we calculated from the Fourier series, the coefficients, and I put those, so the Fourier sufficient coefficients are here on the red, so there is quite good match between the what we measured and what we predicted from the computations. So actually those kind of theoretical computations of Fourier series is quite useful when we want to see that if our devices are working correctly and we are calibrating them, for instance. One thing is that, of course, I mean, this in theory says that this line spectrum has very narrow width, but in practice it has some width, and that is due to the fact that we didn't take the whole periodic signal, but instead we just cut it and look at it in some time, and that this cutting thing causes the spectrum to get a little bit wider. Okay, so that was with periodic signals. Now if we start looking at pulse signals, we instead of Fourier series, we look at Fourier transforms. So if we have this continuous time periodic signal, where you have this pulse, and that repeats once per T0, and compare that with just this pulse. So this we would analyze with Fourier series, and its power spectrum would have this unit of watts per hertz, and would have this sort of form. And then when we are looking at just this pulse, just finite duration, it is actually has its energy is divided into all frequencies. So this is a continuous line where this is only defined in those frequencies which are harmonics to this of the nominal frequency 1 over T0. The shape of this function actually is a sync function. It's kind of a Mexican hat. This is something that appears many times in signals analysis in frequency domain, those sync functions. Okay, now we are ready to look at systems in time domain. And one way of looking at how a system behaves is to do what is called impulse response tests. For instance, we have a chemical factory and we want to see like how long it takes the material to go through the factory. So we can do a marker test where we put a radioactive material on this flow and then measure the amount of radioactivity, the output, and we would get something like this, for instance. So this would be an impulse response of a chemical factory. The most important class of systems is linear time-invariant systems. They are such systems that their behavior can be described with linear differential equation, where the parameters, here this A's and B's, are time-invariant constants. Hence, it's time-invariant, and this. And this kind of LTE systems can describe well electric circuits or mechanical systems. So let's look at some examples of first order systems. So the order of the system actually refers to the how many derivatives of this output y we have in this equation. So there's the first derivative, so hence it's a first order system. If you would have a second derivative with respect to time of the output, then we would have second order system and so forth. And if you look at these electric circuits, the order of the system is somehow related to the how many active components like condensators or coils we have. So the simple RC circuit, so we have this resistive and then we have the condensator. This is a simple system that is where y is the output voltage and x is the input voltage, and their relationship follows this first order equation. Also, if we have take some simple mechanical system, we have force affecting this mass, and then there is a shock absorber, so then y is the speed of this mass. So this also would follow first order equations, but we can also model more complicated systems with this kind of simple dynamic models. For instance, here we have a chemostat where there's some cell culture, and then we are the input is the nutrient concentration coming to this cell culture, and the output is the biomass of these things that we are want to grow there. Or it can be even more complicated system in some sense that it already contains some control loops and whatnot. So here's an example of a direct torque controlled speed drive, where we have the input is the reference speed for this motor, and y is the output speed of the measured electric motor speed. So that this kind of system can also be modeled with first order equations. So these kind of dynamic models, they are used a lot and appearing in many very different type of systems. So we discussed this impulse response a little bit. So impulse response in theory means that we take a pulse of a unit area, but we reduce its width towards zero, so it becomes infinitely high pulse. And we put it into the system and then measure what comes out. In terms of electric circuit, this is equivalent for this RC system to first charge this capacitor and then look how the capacitor is charging. And this kind of impulse is typically represented by this delta function, so direct delta function. And this is an example of this kind of special signal So we put this impulse in and we get the response of the systems. Okay, so let's look at some practical example of impulse response. So we want to understand the acoustics of a concert hall or a church or something. And we go there, we have some source for the sound, and we make a loud bang, and then we measure how with microphone at some locations how this bang propagates through the air to this microphone. So here's an example of this kind of a impulse response of a church hall. So we, there was this loud bang and then some weaker sound. So the loud bang was the direct path signal, and then there are weaker reflected signals coming in. Now, if we have recorded sound in the studio, so here's some singing in the studio.
Yeah.
So there were no echo. And now we put that sound and want to hear how it would be in this concert hall. So now we can model this as a linear time invariant system and look at how this in time domain works. Actually, it turns out that we need to use convolution integrals. So that's a convolution of the impulse response of the church hall with the singing sound. And now when we do this convolution, the result sounds like singing in the concert hall. So let's try to hear it. So there is now more echo in because of the hall acoustics. Okay, so let's now look at the systems in frequency domain. Here's an example of a speaker and how that speaker is behaving in frequency domain. So if we put sound with certain frequency in, then we see that how much the speaker is attenuating that sound. So for instance, with this speaker, if you put very low frequency signals in, those gets attenuated. So whereas then higher frequency components that go through to from this example speaker here. So let's model this frequency response of the system. So we take a signal that has certain frequency f. So this is sinusoidal signal with frequency f, and we put it into this system and observe what comes out. It turns out that what comes out is still a sinusoidal with the same frequency, but it has its amplitude has been changed. So there's some amplitude damping, so amplitude response of this system, and it has also some phase shift due to this system. So to characterize this behavior, we have it often use border diagram where we show that okay, how much this system is attenuating to different frequency components, and then how much it's shifting the phase. So, and typically these are given, the frequencies are given as radians per second, so this is 2 pi times f. So if you have frequency omega is 1, for instance in this example, we see that okay, there's attenuation of maybe something like 3 dBs, so the power of the signal is reduced to half, and its phase is shifted by minus 45 degrees. And these are typically negative for many systems, because they are negative phase shift indicates that there is a delay in the system. And now we can use this kind of linear systems to build filters. So in signal processing, filter is a device that removes some unwanted frequency components from the signal. And so there can be digital or analog filters, but in this talk I will focus only on analog ones. Example of the use of filters would be, for instance, this in audio case. Here's a simple audio bass management system, so there's the sound coming in, there's amplification. Then we have a low pass filter of the signal that goes to the subwoofer speaker, whereas then there's a high pass filter that goes to, and the signal goes to the central loudspeaker. So this low passing filter means that it only passes frequencies that are low enough, and then it filters out higher frequencies. And high pass does the opposite, doesn't pass the low frequencies and only passes high frequency components. So it will hear only low frequencies from the subwoofer and higher frequencies from the central loudspeaker. So for instance, if you had signal that had two frequency components, so it has it's cosine t plus cosine 100t, so it's this blue one, and we want to get rid of this higher frequency component, we can filter it. So we pass it through this LTE system, and then so there are two frequencies. The one was lower frequency, which has omega 1. You see that, okay, its amplitude doesn't really change, but it is slightly delayed, but not much. But then if we take this higher frequency, which has omega 100, so we see that its attenuate is actually attenuated by 20 dB, so its power is 100 factor by 100 smaller, and it's also delayed quite a bit. So the filtered output signal is this red one here. So we have almost completely removed the higher frequency component. And we already saw this different kind of filters in this audio management system. So a low pass filter ideally would be such that the amplitude response of this filter would be such that it passes. So there would be no change in the amplitude on this pass band, those frequencies which we want, and then it would be completely cutting off frequencies which we don't want. And high pass would be doing the opposite, so it would be completely removing stop frequencies on the stop band and then passing everything else. Or we could have a pass band, so we only pass frequencies in certain range, but not the others, or stop band, where we just remove certain frequencies and pass the others. So this would be ideal filters. The problem is that, that if you want to realize such a filter, if I calculate what would be the impulse response of such a filter, turns out that it would be this kind of sync function that we saw earlier, which starts at time minus infinity and then goes to time infinity. So it would be non-deterministic. So, and to make it deterministic, I would need to have infinite large delay. So for sure, these kind of filters are not practical. Practical filters, they have this kind of transition band. So if there's pass band, so these frequencies we want to pass through this filter, and then there's the stop band where these frequencies we want to get rid of. So we define that on the stop band, the attenuation must be larger than something. For instance, in this example, we say that it must be larger than minus 60 dB. And then we also define that on the pass band, there can be some attenuation, so this kind of a ripple effects, but this is somehow limited, say, to 3 dB variations. And the higher order of the filter we use, so the higher order system we have, or the, which would also translate to how the more coils and capacitors we would need to realize that filter, then we can make this transition band more narrow. And there are many predefined filter families that have slightly different behaviors. So here are some examples, like the Bessel function, which has flat passband, but then the stop band is very wide. And we want to make the stop band not very narrow, then we might end up having quite low attenuation at the stop band. And then there is also this group delay, which is like how much the signal as a whole is delayed as it passes through the system. And that also varies based on the what is the frequency range of the signal. Ideally, we would like to have the signal that is passed through the system, so it has is in this region. So we would like to have the group delay constant during this this passband, which would mean that the signal just gets delayed but not distorted. But if there is a change in group delay, that also means that the signal while passing through this filter is also a little bit distorted. And these kind of practical filters, they are available in the shop. So for instance, this Butterworth filter is, this is a chip that is available and could be directly put into the, any practical build of a system. Okay, so we have looked at linear systems, but there are also non-linear systems, and the most common non-linear system is a power amplifier. I will only discuss memoryless systems here, so they don't have really any dynamics themselves. It's just some non-linearity. So typically we model non-linear components using Taylor series of this whatever non-linear function they might have. And a power amplifier, which is the most typical example for non-linear component, is well approximated with third order Taylor series, where the first parameter is the how much the power amplifier is amplifying this input signal X, and then there's the third order term that causes distortions. So let's use a two-tone signal to test this sort of system. So we have this first tone and second tone, they go through this system, and then what comes out is those two tones, so that's the linear term, and then we have this third order function which contains all kind of products of the, you can think this as a cosine 2 pi f1 and this is a cosine 2 pi f2t. So we have all these kind of combinations of their sum to the power of 3. So this gives rise to intermodulate components which have frequencies which of a mixture of these two, so like 2 times f1 minus f2 or 2 times f2 plus f1 and so forth. And we also get harmonics of this signal. So if we just put the one tone in, then what comes out is that tone, and then it will come the harmonic components. And those harmonic components, they are called distortions, whereas these mixture frequencies, they are called the intermodulation products. And distortion is something that is happens in quite many systems, like the power amplifiers, and then sometimes it's used in purpose, like in music. So here's some example for distortion. First we hear the sound without distortion, and then with distortions, with different levels of distortion, so we distort it more and more. Without distortion. As we discussed, power amplifiers is the most common class of nonlinear components. So here's the input power in dBm, for instance, and here's output power in dBm. So then the output power is some gain times the input power, so it amplifies that signal. And if we are in this linear region, then there's really not much effects of this amplifier, so the signal that goes out in is just amplified and goes out. But if we start to operate close to this saturation region here, then the signal gets distorted, basically it gets clipped, and then this distortion in sounds would appear if this would be, for instance, an audio amplifier. Here's some example of just a microphone preamplifier. If you do a single tone test, so we see that there's a single tone that goes into this microphone preamplifier, and the harmonic frequencies appear here. Whereas then when we take these two tones signals, put them in, we also get those intermodulation product results. And this kind of two-tone signals, they are really used in practice to check if the amplifiers are working correctly. So it's a very typical test signal. Okay, so let's now look at modulation. So in modulation is typically related to sending a signal so that we shift it to another frequency for the sake of transmission. So in this example here, we have this sound signal that we want to send, and then we have two transmission systems. There's the AM radio and FM radio, and this AM and FM is these typical buttons that you would find in your radio receiver. In most countries, AM amplitude modulation transmissions are not really used anymore, but they used to be in the past, but the frequency modulation is more common. And this is just an example, so we see that, okay, there's the signal that is being transmitted is on the top, and we see that the amplitude is changing as the signal is changing. Signal amplitude is changing, so this AM signal that is being transmitted from the radio tower, or then the FM signal where the frequency of the signal is changing according to the signal that we want to transmit. So the aim of modulation is to transfer an analog baseband or low pass signal to different frequency which is high on higher than the frequency of that signal. And then the reverse process is called demodulation. And we can have different kind of modulation schemes. So linear modulations are those where the signal that we want to transmit, this VT, which is called modulating signal, that is directly controlling the amplitude of the carrier signal, that's the higher frequency signal which describes on which frequency we want to shift the signal. So if we just multiply them together, we get linear modulation. But then we can also have nonlinear modulation where we, for instance, use this signal VT to change the phase of this carrier signal directly, and that's a nonlinear modulation, so or then we can change the frequencies, and then we have another class of nonlinear modulation, so that's the FM modulation. So let's look at this amplitude modulation first, that's a linear modulation scheme. So we have this red signal here, which we want to transmit, and if in spectrum, this is the, if you look at in two-sided spectrum of that signal, it looks something like this. So there are two frequencies in this particular test signal here. And we can generate a carrier frequency which has much higher frequencies. FC is the carrier frequency, so it is just one frequency component on a frequency much higher than the maximum frequency of this signal. And we call this the signal bandwidth is from zero to this whatever is the maximum signal here. So, or typically we define that bandwidth is that where the 95% of the signal power is so far. So this signal has finite bandwidth. And then we take these modulators, we scale this amplitude somehow. We multiply it with this carrier, but then we also sum the carrier there. So in the resulting process, we get signal where we have the carrier present here, and then we have the scaled copy of the signal, and now it's shifted around this carrier, So what happens is that the bandwidth is now doubled. And this is how the signal looks like after this process. And we see that this original signal kind of appears here as the envelope of this new modulated signal. And that we can then use for demodulations. So the demodulation, in principle, what it does is just kind of takes the absolute value of this signal and then filters out the higher frequency component. And this can be done with the simple envelope detector with diode and RC filter. So after this envelope detector, we can directly get out the analog signal that was the lower frequency band signal that was transmitted over this higher frequency band channel. In frequency modulation, what we do is we are controlling the oscillator based on the information signal that we want to transmit. So here's the carrier signal, here's the transmitted signal that we want to transmit. So if this one has high amplitude, we have high frequency, and if it has low amplitude, it has low frequency. And there is a simple receiver. The simplest FM receiver is basically to convert that FM signal to AM and then use the same envelope detector. There are more sophisticated receiver structures as well, but this is the simplest. Okay, so let's go forward and look at now digital systems. So we have some analog signal and we need to take samples in order to process it with the computer. And this is done, the sampling, with analog to digital convert. So we take samples with some sampling interval TS from this signal here, so we get those sample points. And there are some restrictions on how we would need to select this sampling interval or sampling frequency. And that's the Nyquist theorem. It says that if this XT has a certain bandwidth B, so that's, for instance, it's a frequency signal that has the maximum frequency component at B hertz, then we need to select the sampling frequency to be at least twice of that B. Otherwise, what will happen is aliasing. And aliasing is this kind of process that if you have two signals here, so here, for instance, we have this 1 hertz signal and 3 hertz signal. So 1 hertz is the blue one and 3 is the green one. If we take samples with too low sampling frequency, then after the sampling, the high frequency signal and the low frequency signal look exactly the same. So here we see that in the sampling points, those two signals actually have the same value, so we cannot distinguish them anymore. So it appears, the higher frequency component appears as a low frequency component, and this is called aliasing. And this is something that we typically want to get rid of, and that's why we have always a filter before taking samples. Okay, so having sampled the signal, we can now look at its frequency content by performing discrete Fourier transform. And this is actually in practice done by using fast Fourier transform method. It's just a computational method for efficiently calculating the discrete Fourier transform. And this is something that this fast Fourier transform that is implemented in many libraries and can be simply used in almost all programming languages. So good implementation libraries exist, so it can be easily used. And the real-time spectrum analyzer, for instance, is a system which is continuously sampling the channel and then in a window calculating the fast Fourier transform and then illustrating the spectrum on the screen. Okay, so then the final topic of my lecture today is random signals, which is basically the noise. So random signal is a signal that amplitude of which is random, so means that we don't know how it is behaving in time, but we might know what is the probability distribution of it. So for instance, the probability of the amplitude getting some value less than or equal to x, for instance, could be known. but the exact amplitude might not be. So here's an example of a noise process. So it's in time, amplitude is varying quite rapidly. But we can look at the histogram. So what is the fraction of the signal that is on certain interval? A fraction of the time that the signal is on this interval. So this gives the mean. So this has signal has a mean around 3. Then it does look at some other fractions. Then okay, so that's the probability of or the fraction of time that it's very large is smaller and so forth. And this is kind of the empirical probability density function. And actually, in this case, I used the white noise, which has Gaussian distribution. So this is the red one is the actual distribution, it having standard deviation 2 and mean 3. Okay, so let's look at the noise in frequency domain. The white noise, which is the thermal noise, which is always present when we measure something, this has the property that it has constant power density. So the noise power is constant in all frequencies. And it sounds something like this. And this is what you could hear if you have, for instance, an FM receiver and it's not tuned to any channel, then you are listening just a static noise. That's the white noise. If I filter that noise somehow, so I attenuate the high frequency components, I would get then some noises like the pink noise or brown noise. So pink noise, the higher frequency components are scaled down inversely proportional to their frequency, and that would sound something like this. Then in blue noise, we would amplify high frequency components inversely proportional to the frequency, and that would sound something like this. And in general, we have white noise, we can generate the colored noise by making some filter that filters the noise or some other linear time invariant system. If you want to generate violet or brown noises, those can be generated with the linear systems. Pink noise and blue noise are more difficult to generate, so we would actually need some fractional order systems to do those. But anyway, they can be approximated by using certain circuitry. Okay. And in the measurement case, we always have noise present. So that's why also we want to use filters at the receiver to filter out the noise. So here's an example we had. Noisy signal. We filter it and get smoother signal. So this summarizes the kind of basics of signals and systems.